Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. May I welcome you to the second annual Lord Patten Lecture on Social Renewal. My name is Mark Shucksmith, and I'm director of the Newcastle Institute for Social Renewal. I'll explain social renewal in a moment so that you're not mystified all evening what that is, but first some further words of welcome. This is the second annual Lord Patten Lecture on Social Renewal, as I've said, and the first was given by Lord Patten himself last May. And we're delighted to welcome Lord Patten back to Newcastle University for this event, and he's kindly agreed to chair the proceedings tonight. Second, I would like to welcome our distinguished lecturer tonight, Michael Sandel. I believe that Professor Sandel gave one of his 2009 Wreath Lectures here in Newcastle at the Centre for Life, so I'm very pleased also to welcome Professor Sandel back to the region and the city after almost 4 years. Lord Patten will introduce Michael Sandel in a moment. But before handing over to our chairman and our speaker, I will take just a few moments to set this lecture within the context of social renewal. Newcastle University has set out its mission to be a world-class civic university. That means not just being excellent in our research and in our teaching and learning, but being part of a wider community and putting our excellence to a purpose, helping to address the major societal challenges of our time. We ask not just what we're good at, but what we're good for. And to this end, the university has chosen to focus on three societal challenges: aging, sustainability, and social renewal, and has established an institute to lead our efforts on each of these. Now, most people understand what aging is, and most people understand, or think they understand, what sustainability is. But social renewal may be less familiar. In this context, we define social renewal as addressing the question, how can people, communities, and societies thrive when faced with rapid transformational change? In Britain and in many other countries, the impact of globalization, technological change, demography, and the unevenness and perturbing effects of capitalist economic growth are creating challenges of great magnitude to which there are no simple or obvious responses. Old certainties have gone. For many people, the failure to provide convincing responses to these challenges has exacerbated their sense of powerlessness, which in turn threatens to undermine the political process itself. It seems to me that a crucial element of any response is to deliberate and debate what we understand to be a good life. And this is exactly the question which Professor Sandel asks in his inspiring new book, and which addresses crucial moral questions at the heart of our society. On 13th of November 1967, in this very hall, Newcastle University made the historic award of an honorary degree to Dr. Martin Luther King, the only UK university to honor him during his lifetime. In his acceptance speech, Dr. King spoke of three major challenges, urgent challenges, that he sought to address: racism, poverty, and war. Last autumn, again in this very hall, one of his former colleagues told us that today these challenges boil down to just one: injustice. Helping address the profound challenges that affect people's lives across the world remains, 45 years later, the central task of our work here in Newcastle University. Now, I'm very pleased that the Insights series has been able to attract such a distinguished speaker as Professor Sandel, and I'll pass over now to Lord Patten to introduce Michael Sandel.
Thank you.
Chancellor, Vice Chancellor, Professor Sandel, ladies and gentlemen, I feel doubly privileged this evening. First of all, privileged that you started this series of lectures in my name. As I was leaving home this morning, my wife said to me, is this your memorial lecture? Not sure whether she knows something that I don't know. But it is it's a great privilege and always pleasant to be back in Newcastle on a balmy summer evening like this. I'm also very well aware, when I look at the size of this audience, I think our speaker this evening could have filled St. James Park, of the distinction of Professor Sandel. So I'm really honored that he has come this evening. He is the sort of modest man who would recoil from most of the fulsome tributes that introductory speakers would normally give. I'll be brief. He's used to being called one of the world's top thinkers, Foreign Policy magazine. He was called memorably, if I'd been called this, I'd have put it up in lights, the world's first moral philosophy rock star. He is, as you know, professor at Harvard of philosophy, where he went after Brandeis and Balliol College, Oxford, where he did his doctorate. He has attracted an enormous following around the world for the best Socratic dialogues since Socrates. The agora is now a great deal larger thanks to technology, and I doubt there's anyone in this hall who hasn't watched some of those extraordinary lectures from Harvard, which are downstreamed to a grateful world, including people like me, who for a few moments think they understand philosophy. He's written, of course, about rules. He's written about justice. And most recently, a book which I think encouraged a lot of us to think we weren't entirely balmy, a book on the moral impact of market forces and the importance in life of not forgetting the difference between value and price. So it's a great privilege to have him with us this evening. He'll talk to us, and then in his own way, involving, I suspect, some of you in the process, and then be happy at the end to take questions. But thank you very much indeed for being with us this evening.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Chancellor, Vice Chancellor. Thanks to all of you for having me. What a thrill and honor it is to not only to be introduced by Lord Patten. And by the way, when you insisted on being brief, I was kind of hoping you'd carry on as long as you wanted to. But also to give this lecture in his name, especially in Newcastle, given its mission, your mission, of social renewal and of a civic purpose. One of the main arguments that I make, try to advance, at least for discussion, is how we might find our way to a new politics of the common good. And I know of no public servant anywhere who has displayed more dedication to the common good, from Hong Kong to Newcastle to the BBC, than Lord Patten. And I want to salute him and say what an honor it is to be here and to lecture in his name. One of the subjects I would like to discuss with you tonight, it's the subject of the book, the new book, What Money Can't Buy. It really asks a simple question.
Well, it's simple to ask, not so easy to answer. What should be the role of money and markets in our societies? Today, there are fewer and fewer things that money can't buy. If you're ever sentenced to a jail term in Santa Barbara, California, just in case that ever happens to anyone here, you should know that if you don't like the standard accommodations and if you have the money, you can buy a prison cell upgrade. You didn't know that? For how much do you suppose? What would you say? Anybody, just shout it out. $1 million. This isn't a hotel, this is a jail. Per night.
$20.
It's about $90. Now, if you want a way of making some extra money, there are also novel ways of doing this. There are advertising companies. Advertisers want always to find novel places for their advertisements. Some have come up with the idea of what's called tattoo advertising. They buy advertising space on people's bodies, preferably visible places on their bodies. The forehead is a common one. There was a woman who needed to raise money. She was a single mom. She needed money for the education of her son, and she auctioned off space on her forehead, a permanent tattoo for any company that would pay $10,000. Unfortunately, the winning bid came from an online casino. And so for the rest of her days, she will have the advertisement for the online casino tattooed to her forehead, but for $10,000. One advertising executive said he thought it was a good idea, not altogether novel. He said it's a bit like, he said it's a little bit like the old sandwich board, but a bit more organic. Well, these are small examples, but throughout social life, more and more of our institutions are governed by market principles. We have increasingly in our societies for-profit schools, for-profit prisons, for-profit hospitals. This tendency has affected the way we fight our wars. In Iraq and Afghanistan, there were more paid military contractors on the ground than there were U.S. military troops. This isn't because we had a public debate about whether we wanted to outsource war to private companies, but this is what has happened. Over the past 3 decades, we've drifted, almost without realizing it, from having a market economy to becoming market societies. The difference is this: a market economy is a tool, a valuable and effective tool for organizing productive activity. But a market society is a place where almost everything is up for sale. It's a way of life in which market values and market thinking reach into almost everything: family life, personal relations, health, education, civic life. And the question I'd like to put to you for discussion this evening is, should we worry about this, and if so, why? Why exactly should we worry? Now, there are some things money can't buy, even if it tries. Friendship, for example. Suppose I want more friends than I have, and I have difficulty acquiring them in the usual way. It might occur to me to buy a few extra. But the thought wouldn't last long because I would quickly realize that it wouldn't work. It's an interesting question philosophically why it wouldn't work to buy a friend. But most of us understand, sense intuitively, that a bought friend is not the same as a real one. Somehow the money that would buy the friend dissolves the good that we seek. But there are many goods that are not of this kind. There are many goods in social life that money can buy, but arguably shouldn't. And sometimes we can learn about how to figure out where money belongs and where it doesn't by reflecting on the cases, on the kinds of things that money can't buy. Here's an intermediate case. What about expressions of friendship, if not friendship itself? Probably some of you have had the experience of being asked to give the best man speech at a friend's wedding. Has any of you had that? Yes? You know what it's like. It's an honor in a way, but it can also be quite anxiety-provoking. It's not easy to write an eloquent, moving, heartwarming speech for such an important personal moment. Now there is help. There are websites that you can go to if you find yourself in this predicament, and they will provide you a custom-made best man speech. For how much do you suppose?
500.
It's a pretty costly wedding speech. Any other guess? 100? Well, it's
$10.
$10. This is a custom-written wedding speech. $10? Well, it's $149, shipping and handling included. You enter in some information about how you came to know the couple, whether you want a heartwarming speech or a tearjerker or a funny one. And within 2 to 3 business days, they deliver you the speech. Now, in a sense, a wedding speech is a good that money can buy. Up to a point, would it be the same? This is the question that intrigues me. Would it be the same good? Well, it depends. I suppose it depends in part on whether after you deliver it, your friend finds out. I mean, how would you feel if at your wedding, your closest friend gave a heartwarming speech, so moving that it brought tears to the eyes of everyone in the room, including you. And then later, you found out he'd bought it online for $149. Would the meaning of it change? Probably it would. And the clue to this is that most people who give them, I suspect, don't announce that the speech I'm about to give, I just bought online for $149. So if covering up the provenance of the speech is necessary to preserving its meaning, that's a pretty good indication that even a wedding toast, though nominally it can be bought, is a good that's somehow corrupted or degraded or diminished in its meaning and in its value by the purchase and sale. Take books. Now, books have always been commodities in a sense. You can't go into the bookstore and just walk out with the book. You have to pay for it. So in that sense, a book is a product. But books have never been thoroughgoing commodities. Take the practice of paid product placement. It's familiar in television and the movies. Not so much in books. Until recently, there was some years ago a British writer named Faye Weldon. Has anyone ever heard of her?
Yeah.
Pretty well known. And she entered into a deal with the jewelry company to write a novel that included paid product placement. The jewelry company was Bulgari Jewelry, and the contract specified that she had to mention, in exchange for a payment, the name Bulgari at least a dozen times in the novel. The title of the book, aptly enough, was The Bulgari Connection. Now, she came in for some criticism. Many critics complained about the clunkiness of the product-laden prose that resulted. But do you want to hear an example? Here's one. Quote, "A Bulgari necklace in the hand is worth two in the bush," said Doris. Or here's another one. Quote, "They snuggled together happily for a bit, all passion spent, and she met him at Bulgari that lunchtime." Fortunately, product placement, paid product placement in books hasn't really caught on, but I suspect that with the advent of digital publishing and electronic readers, the experience of reading will be brought in closer and closer proximity to commercial advertising. Last year, Amazon put out two versions of its popular Kindle reader, the standard version, and then an almost identical version for $40 less. The only difference is that on that Kindle, the cheaper one, you had to be willing to put up with banner ads on the homepage and on the screensaver. Would it be worth it? Maybe for some, it would. Now, what seems to be objectionable, there seem to be two worrying things about putting a price tag on everything. One of them has to do with equality and inequality. The more money can buy, the more it matters who's rich and who's poor. If the only parts of life governed by money were the ability to buy yachts or to take fancy vacations or to buy BMWs, inequality wouldn't matter all that much. But if money can buy essential ingredients of the good life, access to a good education, to decent medical care, the ability to live in a secure neighborhood rather than a crime-ridden one, political voice, the ability to make one's political views heard. When more and more of life depends on money, inequality matters much more. And so part of what's happened, I think, in recent decades, is that as more and more of life has been governed by market relations, the sting of inequality has sharpened. Inequality matters more when money buys more. So that's one reason to worry. But even apart from questions of equality and inequality, there's a further reason to worry about putting a price on everything. And that is, as we saw with the example of the paid best man speech, sometimes marketizing a good, putting it up for sale, changes the kind of good it is, changes its meaning, may even degrade or corrupt the meaning of that good. And it's a difficult thing to sort out in advance which goods and social practices will be diminished or corrupted by market valuation in exchange, and which will survive untainted by the buying and selling. And so that's really the question that I would like to put to you tonight. And to do it, I would like to see what you think about the following proposal. It's to do with refugees. Now, there are more refugees in need of asylum each year than there are countries willing to take them. So one proposal advanced by an economistically minded law professor was to convene an international convention to work out a formula of assigned refugee asylum quotas for each country, probably based on per capita GDP or some such measure. But in order to persuade the countries of the world to accept higher assignments, higher numbers of refugees than would otherwise be the case, add a provision that enables any country, once it's received its assignment, either to admit that number of refugees each year or to pay another country to take them instead. Tradable refugee quotas, you might call it. It's similar to market-oriented schemes that have been proposed for reducing greenhouse gas emissions, tradable pollution permits. Let's just see by a show of hands what you think about the proposal for tradable refugee permits. The argument is it will enable more refugees to receive asylum than would otherwise be the case. How many would be in favor? How many think it would be worth a try? Raise your hand. Go ahead, we'll have a discussion. You can, that's all? It's only about a dozen people. How many would be opposed? Large number opposed. All right, well, we need to hear from some of you brave souls who, in some cases, timorously raised your hand. Let's first hear from those in the majority who oppose it. Let's hear those arguments. And then we'll see if there's someone who can argue the case in favor. Who will get us started by explaining why, those of you who oppose it, why do you oppose it? What's wrong with it? Remember, it's giving, the argument is that it gives more places to refugees in need of asylum than would otherwise be the case. Then why oppose it? All right, why don't we get a microphone? Go ahead, stand up and tell us.
No.
Yes, yes, go ahead.
Because it would mean that the rich countries can say we don't want these people and send them to the countries that don't have that privilege to do that, or, and that it'd be better that everybody should have to take an equal amount.
Maybe it would be better that every country should have to accept its assigned refugees, but suppose, just accept for the moment the assumption underlying the proposal, which is that if you do it that way, the countries will agree to certain low levels. But if you give the option of outsourcing the refugees, countries will be willing to take much higher assignments, knowing that they can either accept them or hire another country to do it.
But then you're putting more people into more refugees into poorer countries that can hardly look after themselves, yet alone look after more people.
All right, thank you for that. Who else objects? Would anyone like to add to this? Anyone in the front of the balcony? Go ahead.
It feels intuitively like a simplistic solution to a complex problem. So you just want to say we could try harder to solve it.
But do you have an objection in principle? Suppose it would lead, suppose for the sake of argument, it would lead to more refugees receiving asylum. Would you still oppose it?
Has this got to be a yes or no answer?
This one does. You can give your reasons.
It's impossible to say yes or no, because then we start to get onto bigger examples of solving the problems in the countries where the refugees are coming from.
Okay, what do you say?
What we don't recognize is that the rich countries are the countries most responsible for the number of refugees, and it's them getting out of, or us getting out of, the problems that we've caused. It's rather like the oil companies pursuing oil in the retreating Arctic ice.
Okay, yes. Thank you for that.
Yes.
For me,
I wonder if we have any microphones down here that can reach more quickly. Do we have, who else is holding a mic? Maybe if our other runners could. Go ahead, yes, please.
I think for me the problem is that it has overtones of commoditizing people. And so it's not the same as slavery, but it's sort of somewhere in that very uncomfortable space.
Come on, wait, keep the microphone for a moment. It feels like commoditizing persons and seems morally analogous to, in the same neighborhood as, slavery.
Yes.
But why is that? The refugees are not being enslaved, they're not being forced to work. Is it because it seems as though there's a kind of price on their heads? Is that it?
Essentially, yes. I mean, they're not being enslaved, and there are economic arguments that you've put already as to why it could be a good thing. It could benefit them. It could produce many ancillary benefits, but there is still something troubling,
right,
to my mind, emotionally
right,
troubling,
right,
about such a proposal.
Right. Okay, that's very good. But wait, keep the microphone again. I see what's troubling, and you've helped us articulate it. But what exactly, if it did, hypothetically, result in more places for refugees overall, what exactly is troubling about it? And is it troubling enough that you would forego a scheme that might yield more places for refugees in need of asylum?
To be honest, I would need to think longer,
fair enough.
To come to a decision.
Yeah.
But I would certainly anticipate it would be difficult to get there.
Okay, that's good. That's a measured moral worry that gives us a good place, gives us something to pursue. I'd like to now hear from someone who thinks it would be worth a try, and let's have the person in the back by the column tell us why. And you've heard the objections. Stand up. So what would you say?
Well, I feel that if you were a refugee, you would really, really want somewhere to go, regardless of where that is or why that is, even if it's poorer countries. I feel the poorer countries are only going to take people when it's worth their while, so if we can make it worth their while to take refugees,
right,
I feel that there's going to be a lot more people in this world with somewhere to go and somewhere to live and somewhere not to be persecuted.
And tell us your name.
I'm Alistair.
Alistair?
Langtree.
Alistair, you heard the previous moral worry that it's putting a price on the heads of human beings. It seems to commoditize persons, and though it isn't exactly slavery, it feels a little bit like slavery in that respect. What do you say to that argument?
Well, I'd imagine a refugee feels very ignored and completely worthless in today's society, and so to have a price on their head at least makes them worth something rather than nothing at all.
Aha. Uh-huh. I see. And Alistair, in fact, would you even go so far as to say that maybe the higher the price went on the world market, the better the refugees would feel?
Well, I feel that as long as there are enough safeguards to ensure that the refugees are going to be treated properly and not ignored or persecuted in the countries they go to, they're going to get a quality of life that even rich countries feel permissible for people. And so
right.
I think the focus on quality of life and their standards of living and by extension their happiness
right.
is more important than the actual figure it gets.
Is more important than?
The actual number. It's the fact that we are valuing human life rather than not valuing it.
So and we are valuing human life by putting a price on it.
Absolutely.
All right, stay there, Alistair. Let's leave the microphone by Alistair. And I'd like to hear from someone who disagrees with Alistair, who can reply. What's your name?
My name's Ellen.
Ellen, okay, stand up, Ellen. You disagree with what? All right, then stand up, Alistair. Speak directly, Ellen. Speak directly to Alistair.
Hi, Alistair.
And tell him why you think he's wrong.
Well, I think in our sort of Western society, we have a big problem with creating the stigma about immigrants and stuff. So if we develop this culture where so many people are coming in and putting a price on someone's head sort of fuels this nature that people have of saying, well, you know, people who are here natively, oh, well, you're here because of the goodness of my country, therefore I'm better than you. And I mean, what are we supposed to do? You know, taking everyone from every poor country that has civil disruption until we're full. I don't really think that it's a long-term good solution. And if we create this, you know, really strong stigma of, you know, that'll happen just naturally with the way human nature develops, it'll end up being where we can't think of legitimate ways to help, you know, make these countries develop into ways where people can live in them safely.
Ellen, that's great. I have a question for you. You said that this is placing a stigma. You say that putting the price on the head of the refugee, even for his or her own good, carries a stigma, whereas Alistair said the opposite. He said it shows how much that refugee is valued. Why do you say it's a matter of stigma, the money, rather than valuation?
Because giving a financial incentive to a country is basically saying, we're only taking you for the money. Otherwise, surely you'd give them value anyway and take them without the financial incentive, so you wouldn't need the scheme.
Okay, and Alistair, you say that putting a price on my head displays to the world my value. It's a way of expressing my worth, at least in a certain way. What do you say to the argument that it's actually demeaning, that it's imposing a stigma? What do you say to that?
Well, I think it's a lot less demeaning than the status quo. You look at all the Syrian refugees in Jordan and their current living conditions, and I don't think that's very human, and that's more stigmatizing than anything, because I feel it dehumanizes in the way we force them to live because they have nowhere to go.
So not providing asylum to some whom we could help is more demeaning than imposing what Ellen considers a stigma by using a price.
Yes.
Okay. I want to thank everyone who's participated in this round of the discussion. Really good. So what emerges from this discussion, this debate really, about whether to use a market mechanism to allocate refugees, is whether the use of the market mechanism demeans or diminishes or places a stigma upon the refugees. And if it does, then we have, in evaluating this scheme, not one question, but two. Not only the question, will it enable us to find more places, but will it do so in a way that respects the dignity of the persons or demeans them? Now, I'd like to put to you a different kind of market mechanism that some have proposed and some schools have actually tried out to improve academic achievement. Many urban school systems struggle with children, especially from disadvantaged backgrounds, who fall short academically and who don't study hard. And so some economists have proposed as a solution to provide, for the schools to provide cash incentives for getting good marks or high test scores. They've tried this in New York, in Chicago, in Washington, D.C., $50 for an A, $35 for a B, to try to motivate kids. In Dallas, Texas, they have a scheme that offers 8-year-olds $2 for each book they read. Now, let's imagine that you are the head of a school with some struggling students, and it's up to you to decide whether to try this experiment. Let's see, again by a show of hands, how many think it might be worth a try? See if it works. And how many would object in principle, would rule it out? How many think it might be worth a try? few more than with the refugee quotas. Maybe, Alistair, you're swaying some views about the use of markets. You voted for this? You'd try. And how many would not? How many object? Still a majority. Let's hear what the objection is in this case. Who can explain why, those of you who object, why would you rule it out in principle without even trying, without even trying to determine whether it would work? Yes, we'll pass. Or just stand up and speak loudly and maybe we'll hear you. Go ahead.
When you start putting a price, is this on? Yeah, on children's education, where do you stop? And schools are a lot more about the person, in the individual, rather than just the education. And when you start, you know, awarding $50 for an A, then they're going to come to expect a monetary gain from every achievement that they get, and that's not the way to go through life. I wouldn't want to, you know, just base my morals or my education on the amount of money that I received.
Right. What's your name?
It's Kate.
Kate?
Kate, yeah.
Kate, did anyone ever pay you to get good marks?
No, not at all.
You think it would help if they had?
No, because some of my friends got paid for the grades at GCSEs or A-levels or getting into university. I don't feel like I lost out. You know, I come from a background where money really isn't, you know, the center of all, you know, everything. I think
right. That
if you aspire to it, you can do it without the incentive of money, basically.
Right. And in the case of the friends of yours who were paid to get good grades, did it work in their case?
I don't know whether it was really at the forefront of their minds all the time, saying, oh, I better work as hard as, you know, everybody else so that I can make sure that I can get an A, so that I can get, you know, $200 or whatever, or pounds in this case. But I don't think it made much of a difference to them.
All right, so Kate says she worries that the students will get in the habit of expecting to be paid for everything, and that that's a bad thing. What do you say?
Hi. I just wanted to comment that actually I was one of those people, my parents promised me a car if I did so well in my O-levels and whatnot, and it didn't motivate me in the slightest, and I was rubbish, and I did very poorly. Later on in life, I suddenly came to the joy of learning and just how interesting and fulfilling that was, purely through just getting there eventually on my own.
The joy of learning for its own sake.
Yeah, exactly right.
Not for money.
No, I think there has to be much more creative ways of solving these issues than just throwing money. It's like the lowest common denominator.
Yeah.
Pay somebody's, you know, is a tenner, go and do that.
Okay, now let's hear from someone who thinks it would be worth a try, at least to see if it works. What would you say to the arguments? Go ahead. You're in favor?
I don't see a principled objection at this stage. I think this is very different to the previous question. The objection beforehand was we were comparing the potential positive effects, a utilitarian outcome, against a question on human dignity. Putting a price on a person's head raises those kinds of issues. Here we're looking at, I don't see there being an issue of human dignity here. What we're essentially saying is, well, if we pay children as an incentive to work hard and achieve good grades, will that have a good outcome? And the issues that have been raised so far as well, what could the potential negative outcome be? Would there be an overall negative effect? Will it lead to the distortion of expectations, is I think the point that was being raised from the balcony. Will there be a negative social effect? Because the adults we're raising these children to become will have their expectations distorted by that marketization.
Okay, so you're saying that in this case, it's all about the effects.
Exactly.
And it's not about dignity and respect on the one hand to be weighed against positive effects on the other. Here, the objections you've heard so far,
it's all about how you would formulate the policy and whether or not you could formulate...
About whether it'll work.
Yes.
Or whether it'll cultivate bad habits and therefore won't work.
Absolutely.
Okay, that's good. What's your name?
Rachel.
Rachel?
Rachel Clement.
And, all right, well, this is an interesting suggestion. So the question is, I suppose one question that might be asked, Rachel, of your view, is what would count as this scheme working? I should mention what happened in these experiments. The cash for grades did not seem to improve test scores or grades, but the $2 for each, the $2 did lead those 8-year-olds to read more books. It also led them to read shorter books. But the real question is, as Kate worries, what will become of these kids later? Which is another way of asking the question, what is the lesson being taught? Are we teaching them by offering them money to read books that reading is a chore to be done for pay? If that's the lesson they learn, then, as Rachel says, chances are the scheme will backfire because when people stop paying them, they'll stop reading books. And it won't have worked. And we can tell whether it's worked or not by, in principle, counting up the number of books, if we could do comprehensive surveys, read by these children now and later. But there is another possibility, which is that the money being paid gets them to read just for the money, let's say, but maybe then they acquire the joy of reading. Maybe they come for the money, but find themselves drawn in. In which case, when the money stops, they will have acquired the intrinsic love of learning and carry on reading. Now, you could say, and Rachel makes a powerful argument, this is all about what works, what will lead these kids to read more books now and extend it into the future. Fair enough. But is it only that? One of the reasons we might hesitate, I think, to pay kids to read is not only because we're not sure whether it will lead in the long run to more books being read. Maybe part of the point of education is cultivating certain attitudes toward learning for their own sake. Consequentialism, Rachel, aside. And if that's the case, then we have to ask ourselves a normative question that goes beyond what any survey about number of books read could tell us. What attitudes and norms and values does this system promote? A friend of mine pays his young children $1 for each thank you note they write. If someone takes them out to dinner or gives them a gift. I've received some of these thank you notes. And I can tell by reading them that they were written under a certain pressure. My wife and I look askance at this practice. We wonder how these kids will turn out. Now, it could be that by writing thank you notes for pay, they develop the habit of writing thank you notes. The habit takes, they eventually learn the real reason to write thank you notes, which is the expression of gratitude, such that when the money stops, they carry on writing them for the higher motive, not for the lower one, in which case all will be well. But it could also turn out the other way. It could be that the lesson they are being taught is thank you notes are the sort of thing one writes for pay. And if that's what they learn, when the money stops, so will the thank you notes. That's the consequentialist concern of Rachel. But not only that, they may find it difficult ever, Rachel, to learn the virtue of gratitude, in which case their moral education will have been corrupted. That's a moral question that's independent of the, strictly speaking, consequentialist effect. Now, we've been discussing the way in which market mechanisms and cash incentives can change or corrupt or crowd out attitudes and norms worth caring about. We've used some small examples to test our intuitions, but one can see this writ large. In Switzerland, some years ago, they were trying to decide where to locate a nuclear waste site No community wants one in its backyard. They identified a small town in the mountains of Switzerland as likely to be the safest place. But under the law, the local community had to approve. And so before the decision was made, a survey was done of the residents of this town in Switzerland. And they were asked, if Parliament chooses your town, will you vote to accept the nuclear waste site? Despite the risk, 51% said yes. Then they asked a follow-up question. They sweetened the deal. They said, now suppose that Parliament chooses your town and offers yearly financial compensation to each resident of the town, up to 6,000 euros a year. Then would you accept? Now how many do you suppose said yes? What do you think? 70? 85? 100? What? 35, lower. This is like an auction here. The number dropped from 51 to 25%. The number fell in half when money was offered. Now, from the standpoint of standard economic analysis, this is a paradox. Normally, if you pay people to do something, you get a greater willingness to do that thing, not less. So what do you suppose happened? What explains this seemingly anomalous result? Anyone, just call it. What do you think? It could be that. So did everyone hear? One possibility is that when they started offering the money, the people thought, gee, this must be riskier than I thought. I don't want that. So it could backfire for that reason. But they tested for that explanation, and they found that the estimate of the risk by the respondents was about the same before and after the financial offer. So while that's a plausible account, something else must have been going on. What do you suppose it was?
Oh, well, I think maybe the local community think they are contributing for the country when they're allowing the waste to bury in their backyard. Well, when the government are paying them, they think that their lives are tradable, or the government put a price on their lives.
Right.
So that's probably they have a sense of contribution to their community.
Yes, yeah, thank you for that. That seems to be what was happening, because when they asked the people who changed their minds, why did you change when the money was offered? Many of them said, we didn't want to be bribed. And so before, when they were asked without money to accept it, the majority was willing to accept it for the sake of the common good, out of a sense of civic responsibility. But once money entered the picture, the nature of the question and of the relationship changed. What had been a civic question, a question about the common good, now became a transaction, a financial deal. And whereas people were willing to make a sacrifice for the sake of the common good, they were not willing to sell out the safety and the health of themselves and their families for money. That's why it felt like a bribe. In Israel, there were some kindergartens, daycare centers, that had a problem faced by all such kindergartens, parents coming late to pick up their children. So with the help of some economists, they established a fine for late arriving parents. What do you suppose happened? More parents came late. Now, here again, it's a paradox if you're thinking in terms of the price effect, as the economists call it. You place a price on something, and yet more people do that thing. Here again, it seems that the money changed the transaction, the meaning of the relationship. Before, when parents came late, they felt guilty. They were imposing upon the teachers. But now that they can pay for a late arrival, it's like paying for a service, like hiring a babysitter. What these examples suggest is that money and markets sometimes change the meaning and the character of goods. Economists often assume that markets are inert, that they do not touch or taint the goods they exchange. And this may be true enough if the goods in question are material goods. If you give me a flat screen television, or sell one to me, the flat screen television will work the same either way, whether it's a gift or a bought product. But the same may not be true if we're talking about the marketization, the buying and selling of personal relations, health, education, teaching and learning, civic life. In these domains, introducing market mechanisms and market values may crowd out non-market goods worth caring about. If this is true, there are two important implications. One is for the way we conceive economics and teach it. In the 20th century, economics came to present itself as a value-neutral science of social choice and of human behavior. This is different from the way it was originally conceived by Adam Smith, who saw economics as a branch, as a subfield of moral and political philosophy. Now, the picture of economics as a value-neutral science, I think, was always questionable. But at a time when economics has elevated its ambition to explain not just unemployment and inflation and banks and stocks and foreign trade, but all of social life, it's less and less plausible to think that economics can possibly be a value-neutral science for the reasons that emerge from our discussion. If market transactions don't leave goods undisturbed but sometimes change their meaning, then we have to ask not only about efficiency in deciding whether to use a market, but also about whether the market mechanism will corrupt or crowd out attitudes and norms worth caring about, and that is clearly, unavoidably, a moral question, a normative question. The second implication is for our public discourse. During the past three decades of market triumphalism, we have embraced implicitly the assumption that markets are the primary instrument for achieving the public good. And this assumption has been widely shared, despite differing actual policies, across the political spectrum. And at the same time that this market faith has deepened its hold, something else has been happening. The terms of public discourse in democracies have been hollowed out, emptied of larger meaning. Our politics has become increasingly managerial and technocratic. And this, I think, is because we shy away from engaging with contested questions in public about how to value goods, and for that matter, what the good life consists in. We shy away from those debates because in pluralist societies, we worry about disagreement. And disagreement there unavoidably is when it comes to questions of virtue and the best way to live. But the result of this shying away, this bracketing, this setting aside substantive moral and even spiritual questions is that we have a kind of empty politics in which economics has crowded out democratic politics. It's as if we have outsourced our moral judgment for fear of disagreement to markets. But we look up and find now, after the financial crisis, and as markets govern more and more of life, we look around and we find that trying to step back from and avoid engaging in politics, in public discourse, with these big questions doesn't leave them undecided. It simply lets markets decide those questions for us. One of the most important features of social life that the market triumphalist faith has eroded over these decades is commonality. Because at a time of rising inequality, putting everything up for sale creates a condition in which there are fewer and fewer public places and common spaces when men and women from different walks of life, different social backgrounds, encounter one another in the ordinary course of life. Increasingly, the affluent and those of modest means live separate lives. We live and work and shop and play in different places. We send our children to different schools. This isn't good for democracy, and I don't even think it's a satisfying way to live, even for those of us who may inhabit the privileged precincts. And here's why. Democracy does not require perfect equality, but it does require that people from different walks of life encounter one another, bump up against one another in the ordinary course of living their lives, because this is the common shared experience that enables, that teaches us how to negotiate and abide our differences. And this is how we come to care for the common good. And so in the end, the question of markets is not really an economic question. It's a question of how we want to live together. Do we want a society where everything is up for sale? Or are there certain moral and civic goods that markets do not honor and money cannot buy? Thank you very much.
Okay, I think we've got 10 minutes or so for any questions which you may want to put to Professor Sandel. Who would like to start? Yeah.
I'd like to ask you your view on an issue fairly current about universal benefits versus needs-based benefits, and the case that I think is quite compelling that says universal benefits, at least some, should be maintained because they provide some kind of binding mechanism.
Some kind of
binding. Social
I see.
Mechanism.
Yeah, all right. It's a great question, and this is much debated, universal versus targeted means-tested benefits. The argument, obviously, for means testing benefits is that at a time when resources are limited, the resources should be directed to those of greatest need. That's the argument for means testing, clearly. But the counter argument is precisely the one you suggest, that even though it's counterintuitive from the standpoint of distributive justice, to say that people, regardless of means, should have access to certain benefits. Having benefits be universal is a way of giving tangible and concrete expression to the idea that we are all in this together. And I think there's not an easy way to resolve that, the clash of those principles. I would simply say this: whether it may depend on the public character of the benefit and the way it's provided. If it's a check in the mail, the concern about cultivating a sense of shared common space and practice may be different than if the shared benefit has to do with creating public institutions civic places, public transport, gathering places, whether cultural centers or clinics, that everyone, rich and poor alike, wants to use because the services provided are of a high standard, and it provides class mixing institutions in a society. And I think one of the great defects of the market-driven societies we increasingly inhabit is that there are few and fewer such spaces. So I've not perhaps given a definitive answer except to say it matters all the more, the universality and the solidarity expressed, when the benefits at stake, the public services at stake, bring people together, the most important example being schools. Schools should be universally provided precisely because it's not just providing access, it's creating a common space and a common experience that's important for democratic citizenship.
But of course, as a citizen, you can be entitled to a benefit, but not claim it. Should I claim winter fuel allowance? Now, here I'm being hypocritical, because I could show you my freedom pass.
That's for the bus.
I'm a twirly. I'm a twirly. If I get to the station before 9:30, it's too early. So.
But I want Lord Patten to be on the bus because that's I don't care so much about your fuel allowance because nobody knows whether you claim it or not. But that everyone in the society use public transport is very important in not only preserving the constituency for good public transport, but it creates common spaces, common experiences, common encounters. So it's a great example of the difference between riding the public transport and claiming a fuel allowance that's nobody knows. That matters in deciding this question.
Gentleman with a hand up. Yeah.
I'm very tempted to ask this question to Lord Patten as a former member of Margaret Thatcher's government, but my question is to you, Professor. The last 30 years in the States and in this country has shown, regardless of political color of government, a widening gap between the rich and the poor. But there are countries, Japan, and I think many of the Scandinavian countries, which this hasn't been true. And I just wondered what you felt characterized what those governments have done in order to narrow rather than widen the gap between rich and poor.
A critic of the view I've been advancing might say, well, Japan has paid a heavy price in sluggish economic growth during this period, whereas the Anglo-American world has had more growth and more inequality. I don't think that's exactly, I don't find that a fully satisfactory answer, but that would be a familiar answer. But I do think that social and cultural patterns and traditions and commitments matter. And some societies do have strong traditions. One sees this even looking just at executive pay, the gap between CEO pay and the pay of the average worker is a yawning gap in the US, quite large, though not as yawning in the UK, and relatively, almost minuscule by comparison in Japan, for example. And that puts in question the often heard argument that the reason for enormous pay differentials is simply that CEOs have to work so much harder. I don't think CEOs in the U.S. work harder than those in Europe, and I don't think those in Europe work harder or are more gifted than those in Japan. I think these are differences of culture, economics, and politics, not of the way in which markets reward hard work.
Do you think there's also a concept of seemliness which has been diluted in some of our societies?
Yes, in the US it's not really a source of embarrassment if a banker or a hedge fund manager makes $1 zillion. It's a source of pride. Whereas there are other societies, and this goes back to the question of culture and norms, where there are traditions of solidarity that generate a certain kind of embarrassment at great yawning gaps. And to speak of seemliness, I love the language of it. In the United States, few people would say it's unseemly for those hedge fund managers to make. So in a way, the language, it's a cultural quasi-aesthetic language rather than a, whereas in America, people would say, some would say it's unfair, and someone would say, no, I deserve it, and that would be the clash. And no one would think to say, but is it seemly? That's why, one of the reasons I love to come to Britain.
We haven't had a question from a lady. Well, first of all, Professor. Yes.
It is a slightly academic question. You did some thought experiments with us, and you also talked about real experiments, your example of money in schools. I'd like you to say something about the whole idea of whether it is possible to do controlled experiments, because a lot of the stuff that's coming out of economics has been about experimenting. But in many situations, you have to, it's very complicated.
Yes.
Some solutions might work, but it's very difficult. It's not in social sphere like medical science where we have a tradition of doing controlled trials and experiments. And in this country, you may not be aware, the government's launching a program called What Works in Public Policy. And it's taking the model into social spheres from medicine, where there's been controlled experiments and deciding what drugs. Right. So do you have views on, because you're indicated that in certain instances, markets can work. How do you actually do the experimental process?
Right. I'm a little wary of experiments in the social sciences. I don't think they work quite as reliably as in the medical sciences or the natural sciences generally. I am very much in favor of making economics more empirical and less formalistic, less scientistic. And there are ways of doing empirical studies about the effects of various incentive structures. Some may involve experiments, though I think there still needs to be a good deal of skepticism about how any such experiment is designed. But I think economics should change in two directions. It should become more, it should be reconnected with moral and political philosophy. That was the main argument I was making about economics in the lecture. But also it should become, I think, more empirically oriented, because too much of economics is not only scientific and claiming to be value neutral, but also divorced from the world. And purely a model building, formalistic. And so I do think that empirical studies matter, though they needn't necessarily be experiments designed in a social scientific laboratory. Looking at what happens in the world, there's something to be said for that.
Gender balance, yes, there's a lady at the back, pink, yeah.
Yes, along the lines of what you were saying earlier about Scandinavia and differentials, about 20 years ago, I met three young American men living in Scandinavia. They said they wanted to get away from the sexual capitalism of America, where women traded on their looks in order to get a man of wealth and power. And they said in Scandinavia, a woman comes up, she's not interested in what your job is or what your car is, just if she fancies you or not. That seemed like quite healthy. But my question is, you talked about us becoming more isolated, gated communities. I wonder if the nation state itself is a gated community, and whether we should be working towards abolishing borders so that we as human animals can move to areas where there's better grass to graze or where our children can have a better life, that would be a healthier dynamic in the world.
Well, this is one of the great questions, one of the great global questions that political philosophy has to sort through. What is the moral status of national boundaries, and what should be policies toward immigration? And many of the arguments against open immigration are economic arguments, the worry that jobs will be lost and wages will be driven down and benefits will be claimed. But another more challenging argument against open immigration that some advance is that communities should be able to cultivate and affirm certain aspects of character and identity over time. Now, I don't think that's a decisive argument against open immigration, but I think that the debate about immigration should address the broader cosmopolitan universalist human aspirations suggested by your question, and put them alongside arguments about communities of character and shared identity. That should be the debate, or at least a good part of the debate about immigration, rather than some of the lower concerns that inform the debates we commonly have about immigration. So I don't have a quick and direct answer except to say that the ethical principle that you suggest is powerful and needs to be taken into account along with these other considerations.
Last question. Lady with glasses, right arm in the air. Yeah.
My question goes back to the refugee example. We put prices in human life every day. We have life insurance, we pay people if they're relatives die in plane crash and stuff. Should we stop doing that altogether? Putting a price on human life? Because that's what people seem to object to.
Right. People, it does seem to be objectionable to put a price on life. And yet, as you say, life insurance policies do that. Annuities implicitly do that. Pensions do. Compensation for loss of life puts a kind of value on life. But the question is whether the prices we place on life in those kinds of cases are all-purpose prices that give us a full account of the value of human life. It does go back to the discussion we had, because one argument that we heard was that by putting a price on a life, on a human life, we make explicit the value of that life. And that's an affirming thing. And then we heard a counterargument that suggests, no, putting a price on a life is not an affirming, but a demeaning thing. And in order to sort out that debate, we have to ask ourselves a question that lies right at the heart of our topic tonight, which is, how should we properly value goods, including human life? How should we assign value? And one of the appeals of letting markets govern is they seem to enable us to say, if two parties to a deal agree on a price and exchange a good, two consenting adults, each of them decides the value of that good for them, and nobody else looking on, certainly not the society as a whole, has to take a view about how to value, how properly to value the goods they have exchanged. And so it's tempting. I think this is the deepest allure of the market faith. It's not that markets deliver the goods or greater GDP. The deepest allure is that it seems to enable us to avoid judgmentalism. Who's to say what is the right way of valuing reading a book or giving refuge to giving asylum to a refugee or an organ that someone needs for an organ transplant? Who's to say, just let the parties make their deals and then the rest of us don't have to engage in those messy debates? And my argument in the book and in the discussion tonight is that allure misleads us. It misleads us into thinking that we can possibly have a public life that avoids moral judgment of this kind. And instead, we need to engage more directly with competing ideas about how we should value the good things in life. Not because we will agree, but because having a morally more robust kind of debate about the social goods and the human goods we prize will lead us to learn, at least learn more about views with which we disagree. And even where they don't lead to agreement, may deepen our democracy and make us better citizens.
I'm sure you'll all agree that that was as great a treat as we all expected it to be. There are two things that I'm sure you can do as a consequence. The first is to go home and on your laptop or computer, look up, say, the series of lectures on justice, which are streamed to the world happily by Harvard University, which it's conceivable, and it's a point we didn't discuss this evening, has a slightly different discourse on some aspects of the market, the relationship between higher education and the market, than is traditional in Europe. But that's a discussion for another day. The other thing you could do, which would, and it's an area where Professor Sandel and I are wholly in favor of market forces, is to buy a book. and I think the signing is going to be outside. So if you want a book, I'm sure you all want a book. If you want a book signed, Professor Sandel has about half an hour to oblige. But I just want, once again, on all your behalfs, to thank him very much indeed for coming to Newcastle this evening and for that performance.
Can I just say thank you again to Professor Sandel. I'd like to give you this gift on...